Say what again? Say what again? I dare you. I double dare you. Say what one more goddamn time.
You know what he's saying. Hi everyone, and warm welcome to a special episode. You're gonna be double funked up today. First out is Neon Romeoz, maybe one of the funkiest live acts out there. And after that, the review and some extra from the interview with Jellybean Johnson. And yes, there is a connection between them both. Neon Romeoz have mixed a track on fDeluxe album, a group in which Jellybean Johnson is a member. And St. Paul Peterson, the singer in fDeluxe, is going to contribute to the upcoming album with Neon Romeoz. If you're still not convinced and you wonder, who are those Neon Romeoz? Well, I ain't going to waste my time convincing you too much, but I'm going to give you, let's say, I give you 16 seconds. Yeah, that's all. And that's because I'm in a good mood today. 16 seconds from a track from their upcoming album. And if you're still not funkified or have had your head bounce to this track, well, yeah. Okay, you might not still be convinced to 100%. You might wonder, yeah, they're good in the studio, but what are they capable of live? Well, I'm gonna be a bit more generous this time. I'll give you, let's say, 20 seconds. Okay, are you ready? Here we go. Yeah, you're still here, right? Good decision. Enjoy. Neon Romeoz and Jellybean Johnson. We hanging out by the bar, on the floor, they're shaking assets, and I'm shining just like a star. This girl moving over towards me, she said, man, I wanna touch your ass. I said, honey, please stop drooling, you got to keep it all in your pants, cause I got style. Damn, and that's an order, that's an order. Every last mother up on inhale, we gotta do what we are. What we are, let's dance. That's an order, that's an order. Every last mother up on inhale, we gotta do what we are. Don't misunderstand, I would love to jam. How are things in Stockholm?
Things are great. Nice and sunny, yeah, for the time being.
So you're not practicing social distancing right now, I can say.
mentally, no.
Well, it's a big pleasure and honor to have you on this show. You have this fabulous band, and I know that it has been often talked about as Sweden number one funk band, and that's kind of a good label, isn't it?
Thank you. We can live with that. Ladies and gentlemen, boys and girls, cats and kitties, puppet dogs and dogs, people of all ages gather round, for we are about to present to you one of the greatest, sexiest, finest, coolest bands ever found. Not to mention talented. That's right, all around the world for the funk, baby. So if you want a party, there ain't no party like a Neon Romeoz party.
For the listeners and viewers who haven't experienced you yet, I would say it's a really amazing thing to see you live, and it's like a little bit like jumping into a different world. It's kind of with the outfits and the whole what should we say, uncompromising coolness. Kitsch funkness in all its best forms. It's like, yeah. It's the experience.
Yeah, that's what we aim for, is to try to like take people out of their average everyday life situation and forget about things maybe for a while and come into the world of the Neon Romeoz. And blue jeans, mm-mm, I don't think so. A sexy zoot suit's the only way to go, yeah. All I want is just a little cash, just a little bit. Like I would say somewhere around 2004 we kind of were working on putting together the project, and it takes its time in the studio. We had a club, and you know, the live thing takes over, so we end up focusing more on the live thing than the studio thing.
Yeah.
So but now we had a chance to get back into the studio thanks to this year, the way things are. So hopefully soon we'll have an album out, the second album. And we had this vision of like, what would it sound like maybe if we kind of like imagined that it was produced by Jamie Starr, like along those lines a little bit, like, you know, we were just imagining that. And then Prince passed, like, you know, so. But it's taken on a little bit of other characteristics too. It's not just that, but that was kind of like the seed of the of that project that's going to come out soon.
Yeah, we're trying to create our dream album. What would we like to hear?
Wow. And you mentioned different characteristics, and I think that listening to you, yes, it's a party. It's a funky soul party, but it's almost like a funk and soul university in some way, because it's very educative in some aspect, because you have a different kind of genres and you do references to everything. And if I just handpick something, I can say like, Dreamland, it's like Bootsy Collins. City Lights, it's like Rick James cameo, 70s, 80s. Secret, just another track, amazing track. Have some kind of, could you say it's psychedelic, funkadelic bridges in it.
Yeah.
And sexiness, wow, I like that one. It's the time, it's the kitsch, sexiness, the humor.
Yeah.
We can go on and on. And then the last one, I guess, is Temptress. And I can just hear like in the beginning it's like rock and roll is alive, endorphin machine, and then it went over to this funk chocolate DMSR. Mm-hmm. So I can go on this list. It's like a university of funk and soul references.
It's interesting to hear your view.
Is it by purpose that you try to like mix all those?
Well, sometimes you try to do something, mm-hmm. but then you'll maybe try to like distinctively copy something, but it ends up going through your life experience in your own human filter, and it becomes something else on the way out. Even if your intention is to try to like, yeah. you know, inevitably it just becomes something else, and maybe it picks up, it snowballs along the way, and your life experience spices it with various things like
yeah, and then also when you add the other band members,
yeah,
they have their input, and that song takes on completely different or something else, a little bit better than we actually thought from the beginning.
Yeah, when they have all the personalities involved, it becomes filtered through their experiences and their inspirations.
That's a nice thing about music and collaboration, I guess. Just like, so even if you have different kind of combinations in your music, it's absolutely your own style. It's because it's your, the way you combine it. It's very effective.
Yeah, that's what we hope for. To come up with something that is Neon Romeoz, that is our own.
Been doing this for quite some time, and yes, there are a lot of band members, and it's an energetic show when you're looking at it. But two of you, which were your way into the music, and how did it all start for you? Yeah, Andy,
For me, it was my older brother that came home with all this music, and I remember he came home with Luther Vandross Super Lady with that slap bass intro. And I was so hooked, and I asked my brother, what's this music called? He said, it's fun. But then he came home with George Clinton, Computer Games, and that album was so crazy, I had never heard anything like that. And I asked who it was, and my brother said, it's George Clinton, and he's crazy. And I thought he was like mentally ill. So I thought they actually recorded a mental patient at an asylum. And I was like, this is
and
so weird.
And that created a lot more excitement, of course.
Yeah.
My wife, that was my intention, say. If we cannot make babies, maybe we can make some time.
Find some pretty young and make a rotting city come alive. Rotting city, can't you see? Find some pretty young and me.
Every time I comb my hair, thoughts of you get in my eyes. Just when I reached the point where I stopped peeping, about all the time, imagination stopped peeping. That's when I learned it wasn't stop speaking.
Speaking in drums, throwing it into a tweet. Voice so loud, ringing the mill, banging in the bed. No one hears, nothing's heard, but nothing's said.
You started to adapt that into your piano playing.
Yeah, and then I got into Prince, of course, and through Prince I discovered so much of his influences then.
Yeah, and many of us have had that trip, like
having a discovery of Prince, and then he was on P-Funk, here was some jazz, and here was some stuff. Mm-hmm. I had a conversation with Eric Leeds the other day, and it's like he have opened the doors for so many Prince fans into jazz by making us listen to horn playing. And I remember buying Bitches Brew and all those Meist tracks thanks to Eric Leeds and stuff like that. So I guess we all have our different kind of way of doing this. And Andy.
When I met Andy, it was like I never heard anything like that. When I heard his demos, it was through a mutual friend. He said, I met this American guitar player. It sounds nothing like any guitar player you heard in Sweden. Wow. And it was like he was so out of the box. With I heard the P-Funk thing, and I had never heard anything like that. It was almost the same feeling when I heard when I was a kid and I heard George Clinton, because wow, it was so weird, and I just wanted to be a part of that. Wow.
We always had like guitars and pianos and bongos and like a Vox Continental organ like the Doors had and stuff like that. So there are dulcimers, all kinds of instruments around. And my parents listened to a lot of music and consumed all kinds of music, like Peter Tosh and like Led Zeppelin, Jimi Hendrix, The Temptations, Stevie Wonder.
Wow.
I grew up with all that stuff. Beatles, Rolling Stones.
All of the great ones.
Yeah, and then as time moved on and the 80s started to come around, my mother brought home this album, I think it was Controversy, and I remember it, like dancing around to like weird songs like Annie Christian and stuff like that, and it was like, you know, before Purple Rain, two albums. And then she bought 1999 and I got hooked on that, and then we got MTV and cable hooked up, but I seen the video for Little Red Corvette and I was like, wow.
That's the game changer for many of us, yeah.
Yeah. And then finally, my parents got divorced then, like, you know, so they split up. And then my mother, she took me out to see Purple Rain. She said, you could either choose this movie, Purple Rain or Dreamscape, which was like some kind of thriller horror movie.
Okay.
So I chose Purple Rain, fortunately.
Good choice.
And that was also another thing, like when I seen like the opening scene of like Let's Go Crazy with Prince standing on the piano and playing with his foot, I was like, just blown to pieces, my like, you know, just floored. I was like, man, I want to start like playing more. Like it really hit something, sparked inside of me. Like I was like a little bit interested in instruments, stuff like that. But then I was like one doe's cry. Like, how do you make the drums sound like that? Echo on the drums, like
whole Lynn drum.
I started taking apart those things. And Prince was kind of an inspiration in that in more ways than one. It was like, he was playing everything by himself, and I couldn't really find anybody that could play the kind of funk that I wanted to play. So I ended up having to learn by necessity more to play different instruments and stuff like that, mainly focusing on the guitar though, but I would do demos where I attempt to play everything. Wow. But I didn't know what instrument I wanted to play. I wanted to play the drums, but my mother was like, "Nah, there's this new thing called the drum machine out, and drummers will be obsolete, so don't play drums. You could have a guitar instead." So she brought me this guitar. So that's kind of like how it started. But I didn't take it seriously still. Like, you know, it'd be another like 3 or 4 years until I started to get into it more and really wanted to learn about it. But even then, it was like still messing around with all instruments, not really 100% focused on guitar. I feel high when I'm not. I just get knocked. Just a funk and get the shake of my rump. I'm trying to be U-R-E funk. I feel high, but I'm not. I just get off on the funk. I'm just a funk and get the shake of my rump. I'm trying to be U-R-E funk.
He's talented, yeah.
Yeah. And so I approached him and we started talking and I showed him my demos and he was like, "Man, it sounds like you listen to Slapbak." I was like, "Slapbak? Nobody knows about that band." Like, I mean, wow. they're a great band, but it's like kind of underground. Like, you know, so
there was a natural connection there. Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, there's like maybe a handful of people that I know that know about Slapbak here in Sweden.
Wow.
So we kind of like hit it off and we started talking and he was very shy and he did a lot of background singing. I was like, "Man, you should front a band. You have to be." He's like, "Man, I've never fronted a band. I don't know." So I just kept on pushing him and, like, you know, trying to build up his confidence. And eventually we ended up where we are today. Wow. He's a great frontman.
Well done, Andy. Tell us about the last album.
We had to kind of like produce it and mix it ourselves, and we weren't producers or mixers, and we kind of had to learn how to do that out of necessity too, because
so you're going down the same route and path as Prince with For You, I guess. It took a long time to produce the first album.
I guess so. Some of the ideas were jammed upon and brought forth that way, I guess, and developed online,
because we had our demos first and then we developed those demos when we played live, and then we took that experience back to the studio.
That's also happening on this next album that's coming. Some of the songs have been recorded 3 times now because we've learned so much. I mean, we've been on tour and, like, you know, so the arrangements have like grown into something else. And then sometimes as we're tracking the new arrangements, we'll end up changing it again, like, you know, as we're recording, it's like, "Oh, that was a great idea. We got to put that down." So it's like, you know, sometime or another, we're just going to have to, like, you know, say, "This is it now," and put it out.
So sometime in the future, when we have a super deluxe from you, it's going to be like 5 CDs of different versions.
Oh, yeah.
Years.
So what's the plans for this second album? Is it can you see the horizon of it, or when it's going to be released, or is it still in progress?
It's going to be released, hopefully. We got more than 6 songs finished, and they're being mastered as we speak. And we just got to finish up a couple more songs, maybe 4 more songs, so we have a nice 10 song package. And the name of it, I think, is going to be called Exotic Places.
Exotic Places.
And we have a ballad by the same name.
We also have St. Paul Peterson guesting on, on one of our songs. He played bass on one of the songs.
And his nephew on saxophone and keyboard.
Yeah, I want to come back to that meeting you had with St. Paul. But Exotic Places, what a name. That's what we're longing for, everyone, right now, isn't it? In the Corona times.
Yeah.
So the Cure is with you.
You mentioned it, yeah.
So here we got the Cure.
Maybe you should wrap your legs around my neck for a while.
See if I can make you smile. So, talking of the development of your album, your style, and we have touched a little bit upon different kind of legends or inspirational sources, and you got the opportunity to have meet with, one of the, can I say, one of the 10 key figures in the development of the Minneapolis sound, or something you can say. We got, of course, Prince, Morris Day, Jimmy Jam, Terry Lewis, Jellybean, but St. Paul Peterson is up there in that top 10, creating this Minneapolis sound in some aspect. And can you, for those who don't know who he is, he's a part of the family, and he's a part of maybe one of the foremost musical families in the Twin Cities area, because he got a lot of his brothers and sisters and parents are very talented musicians as well. So by saying that, I bring it back to you. How did you end up having contact with him? And because you also performed with him, and now he's contributing to your album, right?
Yeah, it was actually through his manager.
His manager contacted us and asked us if we'd like to do a remix. And we thought for a very long time, was like, I don't know. And then he kept on bothering us and hassling us and calling us, and finally, like after about 3 or 4 months, I said, okay. No, he really did contact us, and we immediately said, after we did a backwards somersault flip, we said, yes, of course, we will do a remix immediately. Wow. And then I remember Magnus asked me, he's like, what the hell are we going to do? What the hell are we going to do? Yeah. And I said, I don't know, but it has to be the best thing we've ever done.
And it was a deadline. We only had one day to record it.
Wow.
So we chose the song Sanctified from their album, and St. Paul sent us the vocals. He sent us the whole track,
the whole song track by track. So we had like Eric Leeds saxophone, Jellybean's drums, St. Paul's bass line, keyboards by themselves, and the vocal package by itself. So and a percussion track. So
You can see everything that normally is buried in the mix. You can just play with it.
Oh, yeah, it was magical to listen to Jellybean's drum track all by itself. I mean, we were just totally nerding out on all of
Jellybean
that.
Is one we are hoping for having here on this show as well. I mean, he's one of the few who can take this 7793-11 and do it correctly.
But we only took the vocals and Eric Leeds' saxophone, and then we recorded our stuff. So when we recorded it, I had Eric Leeds saxophone in my headphones. It was surreal. It was like recording with Eric Leeds.
Wow.
Plus we kept the percussion track.
Yeah, percussion tracks is also the
original. And I sped it up to like 114 BPMs because I was like nerding out. I was like, okay, let's think about some up-tempo party songs that Prince has been involved with. So I was like, we got Love Bazaar. That's 114 BPM and A Beautiful Night. Another, like, you know, party anthem. That's also 114 BPM. So I was like, let's pitch it up to 114 BPMs, and then take off all the tracks, and we'll leave like Eric Lead, St. Paul, and the percussion, and the whole vocal track with Susanna, of course.
So we started recording our basic track over the vocals, and we called our bass player Tobias, and he came down also and laid the bass. And then we finished the whole thing on this one day.
And then you had the opportunity to play with him live here in Stockholm. How did that gig came about?
I wrote an email to the manager, and I was like, you know, it was so much fun doing that Sanctified remix project there. We'd love to do something else. So he wrote back, well, how'd you like to play live with St. Paul? And we were like,
sure. He was out on the European tour.
Yeah.
So that's how we got the gig in Stockholm when he was playing. He played Amsterdam, London, Paris.
Yeah. He was going to come a second time, but then he just got signed to a record label. So we had a second gig that we were almost booked it at Fasching. And then he got a record contract. And then Corona happened. So
all the gigs got cancelled.
Yeah.
Too bad about this Corona. Yeah. But what an amazing story. And and by doing a good job, it's you get the recognition you deserve.
Well, thank you.
Drum. I want to hear some claps here. Come on. Yeah. Andy, give me some of that chicken scratch, brother. Come on. Come on, Andy. Let me have some claps, baby. Give me some claps. Damn, you get some of that, brother.
I hope you enjoyed Neon Romeoz. Of course, we'll be back with a review of their album once it's released. But first out, the review of Jellybean Johnson's album, as promised. And by the way, don't forget to check out our former guests, Eric Leeds and Jellybean. Because there were a few mentions in the episode you just saw to the family and St. Paul, and if you want to know more, check them out. But as promised, now Jellybean Johnson.
Yeah. Okay, warm welcome everyone to this review episode of Say What. Today we're going to dive a bit into Jellybean Johnson's latest album, but we got a special guest with us today. It's Tim Borgqvist.
Hello.
Welcome
there
to the Say What family.
Thank you very much. Appreciate it. I've been wanting to be a part of you guys here for a long time, but I'm coming back from my COVID, so I'm happy to be here.
Yeah, you've been real sick, but now you're stronger than ever, right?
Well, as long as I can take a sip of my Xenophobia Prince water, then.
Just to give Tim a little bit of introduction before we move on into this amazing album. You've had a long background as an artist promoter, party and concert organizer, etc., etc. You worked with several interesting acts, Terence Trent D'Arby, Dan Reed Network, just to name a few. And you also arranged, 10 concerts with for former guest Peter Allgaard here in Scandinavia. So just to give a little bit picture of Tim Borgqvist, but most of all, and for me personally, I would say that you're one of the biggest and most dedicated music lovers that I know. And you've been to countless concerts all over the world, and I've had the pleasure to share some of them with you. And you got this, what should we say, unreal ability to end up on stage or during the show or behind the stage after the show. And I'm still trying to figure out what's the formula behind that talent.
Well, I've had the opportunity to do that actually with you as well in Paisley Park, as you know. But I think the main thing is that I've always been open, you know, talking to people, taking chances, and I'm kind of coming to some other things later on. But I mean, I liked Douglas from the beginning. When I met Douglas, he was the same. And I just had fantastic memories with Douglas too when we did Glam Slang with Petter in Sweden. And that's basically it. I call everybody I want to call or ask questions. And yeah, I've ended up meeting a lot of artists, Nile Rodgers and Prince and many others. And it's been an amazing trip for me since 1986 when this started. 87 when we met TT and Eric Gadd and many others, we had the signer. Prince was in Stockholm for 3 weeks. It was the world premiere of Signer Times, May 7, 8, and 9. Mm. And we saw him a couple of times at Cafe Opera. That's when the food fight was with Sheila E. and John, Prince's father and everybody. And that was an amazing thing to be there for 3 weeks, living outside in a box and be three nights with Prince at Signer Times and pre-shows and after-shows. And from that day on, I should say 86 was big, but from Signer Times, I was completely hooked.
Yeah, and we could have a whole episode just by these memories, but there are a lot of stories, and hopefully in upcoming episodes we'll go back to them further and dive a bit more into them. But
absolutely,
I don't know, you are parted with the Revolution on First Avenue. You have we witnessed the food fight with Prince. You have hanged off with Shelby and Liv, and you're a good friend with Ziggy Marley and George Clinton, and just to name a few of these things.
That's actually interesting that you mentioned Ziggy Marley, and my reggae thing is big also as well. You see Bob Marley behind me here. But I mean, music overall, whatever it is, I've just managed to, you know, talk to band members and people around the band or the actual artist. And for some reason, I've been invited. And if you make a good impression, you get invited as well. I was invited to the VIP by Chance Howard, who we're going to talk about a little bit today, I guess, since he's singing on this album here. And that was at First Avenue. That's the night when we met the Revolution. And he was just a fantastic guy that night. So, yeah, I've had some nice experiences with these people around.
So it's
nice to have you on board in the Say What family here. And we, just to name it, we met in 2003, I guess, the first time. Maybe we have met in some concerts before, but you know, it's a lot of people. I was hosting an international Prince convention, and it was like 100 of guests from all over the world, and among many panels and performances, and there were also different kind of music competitions. And when the convent weekend was over, it turned out that, yeah, you, Tim, you were the winner of this competition. And there were like signed, I know we have signed books by Per Nielsen. We have like t-shirts and stuff from the founders of Housequake and Prince Org and so on and so on. So and you won the competition, and that was also the beginning of our long friendship. So we got that context.
Yeah, absolutely. That was a fantastic evening, I think.
Yeah. So before we leave you, Douglas and Tim, and go into Jellybean, I would like to, based on your background and all the experience that you had, if I force you, and maybe that's a bit unfair, but if I force you to choose maybe one or two key experience that you had in the in your music loving trip over the years.
Yeah, I mean, I must say that I go back to my water here and say that number one for me is the Xenophobia, Seven Nights Alone with Prince at Paisley Park 2002 in June there. And we got invited in the NPG Music Club. It was $250, but it was pretty cheap compared to other things because it was 7 days and seven nights. And he had guests there like Sheila E., Larry Graham, Maceo Parker. He made Norah Jones famous that week. The air condition broke down. He invited us to a movie. I think it was Vanilla Sky. He treated us for beer and food at the diner. And it was just an amazing, amazing experience. I was there the full week and the music blew us away. Both the day music with the DJs, the early nights, and then the full nights with Prince. I want to be brief here and just mention that from every night, from every show he did, he came out the first time I saw him. It was the third day, I think, with the acoustic guitar. He sat down on a stool and played everything acoustic for an hour. Then the band comes in and blow everything away for 2-3 hours. And the last night, we were sitting on chairs. And when it was at 4:30 in the morning, he said, just kick the chairs all over the place. And we danced, and he played almost a 30-minute Days of Wild. Larry Graham threw his bass, took off his red shoe, played bass on his shoe, and everybody was screaming and dancing. And I was worn out after that week. I had a vacation for a month after that. That was number one
for me. That's exhausting. Thank you for sharing, Tim, and hopefully we get the opportunity to come back to, because I know I've been with a few of these experiences. There are a lot more things to talk about, but now we got to talk about Jellybean. And just to give a start for that, it's actually his first album as a solo artist. He's been involved in so many artists and productions with Terry and Jimmy Jam and all that, and the Prince and the family and the time that they're man, he've been around. And as we say in the interview that we published with him, he is one of the responsible for the Minneapolis sound. Of course, we got Prince and Jimmy Jam and Jesse Johnson, but he was there from the very beginning and had a finger in the time, in the family, in Jimmy Jam. In Prince, he was all over. So he's a very important figure for the music industry history, really. So this album, I think it's interesting, just to give a short, we're going to go into a few tracks further on, dive a bit more into them. But there have been a lot of records from associated artists since Prince left us. We get Marcus Anderson, we get Adrian, we get some kind of, you know, a lot of different albums here with many artists, Ida, Eric and... Judith and Shep, I can go on and on, a lot of them. But many of them have done their own thing, so to speak, and go further on. Of course, there is Prince influences in that. But what I think, if you just start up with Jellybean Johnson, is that it's retrospective in some aspect. It's like he's taking a bit of everything he's been experienced. There's a bit of the rock. There's a Minneapolis sound kind of key horns. There is the 90s rap. There is the 80s Jimmy Jam production. You can hear almost everything. So it's actually in some aspects if you don't include the reissues from Sign of the Times and the things that the Paisley Park and Prince have released since then, this kind of the first retrospective album. I don't know if you feel me in that conclusion.
What's your definitely.
Yeah, it's a trip all the way back to the 80s, early 80s, up until now. It really incorporates a lot of music genres, and yeah, it's all the way from the early 80s soul, like the SOS band or Patrice Rushen, maybe that I can hear in some of the songs.
Yeah,
and of course the Earth, Wind and Fire influence is there, because the arranger of the horns in this production is actually connected. So yeah, it's great.
Great. What do you say, Douglas and Tim? What first impressions?
First impression, yeah. I think it's just like you said, guys. A lot of different genres, especially funk, but absolute lot of rock as well, in a great mixture. And just like you said, Joachim, it feels like you go back to the early 80s, late 70s, and some of the tracks are like the new R&B sound for 2020. So it's a great mix. I really, really dig this album. I do.
And I didn't even think it. Well, I didn't even know. I asked you guys on Facebook here. I thought it was the wrong music you sent me, Michael, because I thought that this is like, I mean, the first listen, I didn't read anything on the website. I just found, oh, what's this? Like 6, 7, 8 artists, because when the music comes on and you hear the girl singing and so on, for me, it was different. And then when I listened to it and read about it, I understand how he did it. And it's amazing that he put together something that covers so many years, like you say, Douglas, from the 80s up till now. And still there is a red thread, so to say, with his guitar solo and the background. Yeah. So you can hear it's him, and still it's so very different. I like it in that way, first of all. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, that's so true, Tim. Nice. And we have had an opportunity to have a talk with him. And I know that actually we met him in Minneapolis also with some situation. And I mean, he's a nice guy. He's real friendly, and he's got this positive vibe around him. And that's what I think you can feel in this album. It's positive. It's, can I say, happy music?
Yeah, definitely.
And that's, I think, yeah. So he managed to get that kind of line, as you mentioned, Tim, that even if it's different artists, different song, different areas of the last 30 years, it's like, it's constant. It's that line in between them. So that's cool.
Absolutely.
We have chosen to, instead of go track by track, we have chosen, as we did with the former review of Garrett Scheidel's album, just to pick one song each. And it doesn't have to be the one we like the most. It could be the one that challenged us the most. So I don't really know what made you all chose the songs you chose. But first on my list, I got Douglas. I don't know. Do you feel ready to go? Which song did you choose?
Ready to go, yeah. I choose number one, actually. Put some jelly on it.
That's lazy. That's lazy.
So funky. It feels like, for me, it's a mixture with Tower of Power, if you listen to the song itself, and a mixture with Bar Case, if you listen to the instrumental parts, and his own way of the Minneapolis sound, so to speak. That's the number one track for me. Put some jelly on it. It's funk and rock and roll all through. I really dig it. Majestic.
Can I add something to that, Douglas?
It's, shoot, man.
You have it right there. I just wrote down a couple of things that hit me with that, and that's that it is, you know, the Prince song, funk and roll, right?
So yeah, exactly.
This is funk and roll a la Hendrix. There are so many sounds in it that goes to James Brown as well, and what you just mentioned with Tower of Power. I think it's a great song to start an album with, that's for sure.
Yeah, definitely, yeah. It's like you can really hear that this is his influence with Tower of Power. That's maybe why he started with this track. So you get this entrance of this 70s funk and his way of Minneapolis sound on the rock, and then go forward. Like I said before with you guys, some of the songs on this album sounds like John Mayer. Some of the tracks sounds like the Swedish artist Robin, for example. We can talk about more about that later, but yeah, it's a great mix with a lot of genres. I really dig this album.
I agree as well. It is a great opener for an album, and it has it all. And I mean, the thing I take away from it is the horns. I think this is the track on the album that have the best horns arrangements, and I think it's one of the favorites when you look at different forums at online and stuff like that. So that's a good one. But Joachim, you have a good one as well. Number 5, right? Is it?
I took the track Imagination. Just to dig into, and as it says on Jelly's homepage, he wrote that Tamar wrote the song. I'm not sure how much of it, if the melody and all things or the lyrics, but she's the singer on this track, and I just feel, the production of early 80s, that's really great. I hear the hand claps, all the drum machine programming, and SOS Band is something I feel like Just Be Good to Me or some songs like that. And
but I can go in again and just comment, since this is my first time. I'm stealing a little time, if it's okay. Imagination. I don't know if you know this, but if you remember, we're talking about Jellybean here. Do you remember the other Jellybean, the Jellybean guy who wrote Who Found Who and those songs for Elisa Fiorillo? And this is a Jellybean song for me, the other Jellybean. This is, I hear Elisa Fiorillo all over the place from when Jellybean did her songs in 87 to 92, like Who Found Who and many other songs. I hear Kylie Minogue as well, but this is an 80s hit. For me, it's LA, Miami, New York 89. Definitely the other Jellybean. And Elisa Fiorillo, she should have sung this song.
Funny that you said it. This other guy, this other Jellybean that you said, he did this famous track by Whitney Houston.
Whitney Houston.
Somebody dance or something like.
Somebody Isn't dance it? With me.
Yeah.
No. Yeah. Anyway.
I want to dance with somebody.
I want to dance with somebody. Yeah. And I just have to say this. For me, this Imagination sounds like Madonna. I wrote this before. This like 80s Madonna.
Yeah.
Sounds like it.
And there's a cool thing with this other Jellybean. I think Jellybean Johnson gets into that in the interview as well. But this first Jellybean, the Whitney Houston Jellybean, actually called Paisley Park Prince during the 80s and wanted Prince to convince Jellybean Johnson that he shouldn't use the name Jellybean because that was him. And and Prince became angry and like, no, I ain't going to change anything. Hang the phone up. So it was kind of an. So he defended Jellybean Johnson. No, he's going to keep his name. So it was kind of an issue. And then they meet many years afterwards at the Grammys, and then they kind of joked about it. And the Whitney Houston Jellybean apologized. So there is kind of a nice, interesting story there.
He's produced hundreds of hits.
Yeah.
That Jellybean guy.
Yeah. So that's amazing. And yes, this is a collaboration. It's Tamar, and I think the whole album is is collaborations, as we said when we started up this review. And that's the history of Jellybean. He's collaborated with so many artists and so many different roles as a guitarist, drummer, producer. So it's, yeah, this is another result of it.
This album. He's collecting all his connections with people and just put this record together with so many different influences. It's really...
And imagination, you mentioned Madonna and every whatever kind of reference there
Patrice
are.
Yeah, Patrice Russian also.
I think about Bria Valente, if you know the album that was released with Lotus Flow. There's one song that's called Tonight at that album, Elixir album. And it's very similar to imagination. So check that one out. Bria Valente, Tonight. Who's up next? Tim.
Well, I can take my song if you want, and I don't think Douglas will be surprised here. I chose number 6 for a very special reason. I only heard it for 6 seconds and I thought it was a Dan Reed Network song. This is absolutely what I liked with Dan Reed Network when they became famous, and because they got famous for putting funk into the rock, which nobody did at that time, like Bon Jovi and those bands. I mean, Bad Blood for me is a rock and roll song. You can hear the funk, you can hear the dance rhythm. I think if I don't mix it up now that the horns come in the second part, it's a fantastic part of the song at the end. If I can use the word funk and roll there again. It just hits me. I didn't know who Tracy Blake was, but I Googled Tracy Blake and I listened to some of his songs and I saw him live doing the Prince tributes in Minneapolis 2018. So I clearly understand that Tracy Blake is a funk and rock guy. So for me, that gave me the vibes. I got my breath back in my life. It was a powerful song. It's not like a super hit, but it's a happy rock funk song that I really, really enjoyed.
Yo, Jellybean, let's go.
Actually, I thought that, Tim gonna choose that song. And you nailed it. Yeah.
There is another one, Shattered Pieces, number 8, which I could just, if nobody picked that, that's the same for me. I mean, it's a rock, funk, average pop rock thing, but it's the mix here again, as we're talking about. It comes like funk, disco, a little pop, Madonna, and then rock, and then, you know, it goes up and down. Yeah. It's that's what I like with it.
Yeah. And I think also...
I can feel those rock songs going back to, like, Lenny Kravitz as well.
Absolutely.
Yeah. And we talked briefly about track number 2. What was the name of that track now?
What is this feeling?
What's this feeling? Yeah. And we had kind of a similar experience of that, because I... Wasn't that, guys? We have done some notes individually, and we have wrote Mike Oldfield, a couple of us, haven't we?
Yeah, absolutely.
So, and Kylie Minogue as well in that. So it's kind of a strange mix, but, well, Jellybean makes it happen. That's an interesting track as well. Track number 2. They're so well produced.
I think I can add quick that sorry to interrupt you, but if you can help me, I hear the Prince drum machine. What's it called again? The Lin.
Yeah,
that's in the end of this song, I think.
Yes.
Or maybe in the background.
And there's an amazing bass line, actually. If you listen to just the bass line there, it's kind of advanced. And then there's the tasteful guitar at the end, and then the kind of whole reverb stuff just opens up the whole thing. Kind of a simple track. No, it's a kind of complex track. It's kind of, I kind of like number 2, but it wasn't that one that I choose. If I took number 7, she can get it. And just like number 1, I think this is a track that sums up the whole Minneapolis vibe in some way. It's like, when we talked to Jellybean, he was like, he was a positive guy. He's like full of energy and very humble. And this
down to earth.
Down to earth. This song is like, I think it captures a lot of Jellybean's energy in a very good way, and it's funky and it's playful, and I also like this guy Law. He was actually a background singer for Amy Winehouse. I think that's kind of cool, and he also done productions with George Clinton and stuff like that. So Law is the singer on this track, and also we have a guest appearance by Tony M, who is from the former earlier version of Prince NPG band. So and also Monty Moore from The Time. So yeah, take this track. It's like it got it all. It's got like yes, there's something from the kind of 80s, kind of it's a bit of modern soul, but there's a lot of fun and the guitar, and there's a segment we are gonna put it up here afterwards, but it's like 40 seconds from I think from 4:05 minutes and up to 4:50. It's like we got the falsetto, we got the breakdown, we got some kicks, we got the synth horns, and we got some piano solo. It's like, okay, there's 50 seconds that capture it all. That's the Minneapolis vibe right there. So
exactly.
If you want to listen to the album, listen to those 50 seconds, and then
you got it.
Come on, ladies and gentlemen, OG Monty Moore, aka Piano Man, play. Yeah,
she could get, come on, get it.
Like to say that number 8, The Shattered Pieces, it sounds like John Mayer for me. That was the track that I meant before. So put it on and think about John Mayer, and hopefully you think the same.
Well, the next song, number 9, Let Me Shine On. Do you hear what I hear there? Because that's Tracy Blake again, and for me, it's a Kiss song. It's straight up a Kiss song for me.
We know that Jellybean have done this Black Cat for Janet Jackson, and I think this is his own Black Cat.
All right,
Janet Jackson's Black. I think Let Me Shine. It's the same kind of rock kind of power into it. And I'm with you on your reference, Bear, but I wrote it his own Black Cat track.
You see how mixed up it is. Cool.
I can also hear some of the. The Time Pandemonium album, like the rock guitars from Blondie, isn't that song on that album?
Yeah, I would say that Bad Blood, the track that you talked about, Tim. Yeah. I wrote Blondie, the Pandemonium on that track, but it could be applied on track 9 as well.
I did that too. Pandemonium 1990, I wrote. Yeah. I mean, that was an amazing album by The Time. That's a little bit of that too.
There's drums by Michael Blend, I think, on Bad Blood, or maybe some other tracks as well. Okay, if we should sum it up and dare to give this kind of scoring from 1 to 10. You can start, Tim.
Yeah, okay, but I would like to add at least that Let's Straighten It Out, number 4, which is sung by Chance Howard. I didn't know he could sing that well. It's a cover by Benny Latimore, I think his name is. And that's just an amazing song. And that's an Al Green, Al Jarreau song for me. Yeah. It takes it up a little bit in the mix for me. So with that song number 4, with Bad Blood, the funky number 1, and then everything else in between, if you say from 1 to 10, I don't want to be like too happy about this album yet, because it could take some listening maybe. And I don't want to criticize it too much. There is a little bit of things in this album that could be more professionally done in the mixes in between the songs, but I don't know if this is the original version or not that I'm listening to. So I'm going to give it a 7. I think it's a good album. It's not a super hit for me, but it's definitely not a bad album. It's worth listening to, and over it could be an 8 maybe in a couple of weeks or so.
I'm with you, and number 4 is an interesting track. I like it. Oh, no, I don't like it. And sometimes I think it sounds like this. What's this Gary Moore
still got the blues for you. And I was like, and once I get that one in my head, I know, no, it kind of destroys it for me because I'm so sick and tired of that song. So when I hear to number four, it's not like, no, it's Gary Moore. No, please, no, it's not Gary. So I'm kind of...
Listen to Al Green. If you listen to Al Green, you'll like it.
Much better. So I got kind of mixed emotions. Right. Yeah, about it. But I would say that overall, I'm also into this seven, maybe 7.5, but I think 7 as well for me. It's not pushing the envelope, this album. It's not something new. And that was not the purpose. It's like, this is what I'm all about, that he said. And and I think that's nice, the variety, diversity, it's amazing. But it also, it's kind of its weakness, because it's a bit all over the place for good and bad. And I think that, I like it, and 7, I would say that's a good number anyway. So I'm with the 7.
Right. I agree totally. Yeah, the diversity, it's like a retrospect, but it's still his first own album. So just by being from so many different ends, it starts in early 80s and goes through so many genres. It's hard to say this is a cohesive production, too diverse maybe. I would say 7 as well.
I agree on that as well. Good points. And Douglas, are you going to make it hard for us? Or?
I would say, for me, it's a great album. A lot of genres. Mixture with funk and rock, funk and roll, as we can say. And it's more than other albums of 2020 had to offer, this great mix, if you look at it that way. And for me, it's majestic. I really dig it. I would say 8, actually.
That's good.
8 of 10.
So we got a bit of diversity even in this group.
Yeah.
Oh, and Douglas ruined it for me. I was just going to sing 07 and... okay.
So next episode, we're going to have a cover by Tim of the song 7. You heard that, everyone.
Exactly, yeah.
I know P Control better by heart if you want to hear a full song with me.
Yeah.
Then we have to make it an X-rated pod. And, we're not really... Good.
Now somebody ain't singing. Come on. I want to hear it way up on the hill. Try it one time. Come on. If you can clap your hands with it, it'll do you no wrong. Don't stop the groove. Everybody sing tonight. Come on. Everybody.
You never get tired of this album because every song is new. It's like you hear Kylie Minogue and Gary Moore and Tony M and Mike Oldfield. I mean, come on. Which album could you ever get those references to. It's kind of unique. So
that is actually a very good point, Michael, that it's very rare that you get an album by any artist except Prince before that you could hear, except Prince's voice then, of course. But I mean, you could hear so many different styles of music. And the critic I was going to have against this album was that, oh, hey, guy, hey, Jelly, can't you do like 10 songs of your own that is funky? And but maybe not. Maybe it's not something negative, because like you say, he maybe planned something here. As long as I get my guitar in it, I sing some songs, I do this and other songs, and make an album for everybody. I mean, and just the fact that we're sitting here talking about an album where we can, if we do it again in 30 minutes, we'll hear other artists and other singers if we listen to it again. So you know, let's talk about it again in a few months and see. But I think it's going to grow.
Yeah, it might grow. I think so.
Good words.
Yeah. Okay, guys. Thank you for this
deep
dive into this amazing album. And we'll be back with new reviews and new episodes soon. So stay tuned and just check us out on both Facebook, Twitter, Instagram, and YouTube, Spotify. Yeah, wherever you find pods and vods.
Take care,
everyone.
Bye. Thank you,
man. I'm so good, man. Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to Bill Music Radio, where the women is fine and the music is hot.
Stay tuned for new interviews and reviews. Don't forget to follow us on Instagram, Facebook, and our homepage for the latest news.